Here we go. So it says evaluate for when x equals negative 2, 0, and 3. Okay, everybody tell me what evaluate a function means.
Solve.
Solve would mean I've got, solve's not even really something we've delved into, but it would be like if I had 3x plus 7 equals 4 and I solve for x.
Like figure out?
Figure out? How do we get that ball rolling? How do we start figuring it out?
Tell
you
what x is.
What's that now?
By knowing what x is.
By knowing what x is, yes. By knowing what x is, and we know what x is supposed to be. It's supposed to be three different things, right? We're going to evaluate it three times. What's the first x we're going to evaluate it for?
Negative 2.
Yes. Here we go.
Yay.
Yeah. All right. So g of negative 2. I'm going to use the function notation. Right? Just means plug in negative 2 for x in the g function, the function that has the main g. 3 times negative 2 plus 5, 6 plus 5, 11. And I'm done. G of negative 2 is 11. Okay. I'm not going to divide by negative 2. We're not going to figure out what g is because it doesn't make sense in this context. That g times negative 2, this notation is saying, plug in negative 2 for x in the function named g. Plug in negative 2 for x, I should say x, in the function named g. There's g, I'm going to plug in negative 2, that's all it means. Let's do it for 0. G of 0, this is easy, because negative 3 times 0 is 0. So all that's left is 5. G of 0 is 5. 5 is what I get out when I put 0 in. And last, g of 3 is negative 3 times 3 plus 5. That's negative 9 plus 5. That's negative 4. So g of 3 is negative 4. Does that help?
Yes.
Make sense?
Was that the answer?
There's three answers.
Yeah.
This one, this one,
there's three,
and this
okay.
one.
Whoa.
Because
it
asks for
three
different inputs.
For negative 2, 0,
and 3.
I want
to
be a wizard.
It's looking for the outputs given these inputs. Right. So as we move along through the year, I won't spend as much time doing a problem than looking at you, hoping to find a face that I might ask you if you understood it. If you want to stop me and ask a question, stop me and ask the question, I'll be happy to answer it. But I'll just assume that since nobody's raising their hand and saying, what about this, what about that, that we can go to the next question.
Yes.
All right. And if you all of a sudden remember a question, say, go back. I remember your question. 31. Graph the function. Part of this is comparing it, it says. Compare to f of x equals x. Now remember, this is just function notation. It means the same thing as y, so if you want to think of it as y equals x, that works fine. If you don't recognize this as a line with a slope of 1 and a y-intercept of 0, I'll restate this as we review before the quiz. If in doubt, you're not sure what to do about a graph, you're not sure how to draw a graph, if in doubt, plug something in for x. Okay? This is going to be a line. We're doing linear functions, so of course it's going to be a line. So you just need 2 points.
The lights have been flickering today because they just flickered in camps.
I haven't noticed it at all.
I heard her screaming.
Well, anyway,
she was just joking.
Something that is easy to plug. I'm going to write f of x instead of y. F of x just means y, it just means the output of f, where the input is x. Like it's just a little more information there. I'm going to plug in 0, that would be easy, I get 0. I'm going to plug in 1, that's easy, I get 1. Right, whatever I put in for x, that's just what I get for y. It's the easiest line you could possibly come up with, right, that is two-dimensional and has a slope and a y-intercept. 1. Anything you put in for x, you get out for y. Y intercept is 0. I got the point 0, 0. I just now also found the point 1, 1. And there are all the other points, all infinity of them. So this is what we call the parent function. Okay? So I'm a parent for the third time. And my child isn't an exact copy of me. Okay? So all lines are not exact copies of this line, but they have this same genetic code. They have some of the same markers, right? Like they're straight lines, they have slopes, they have y-intercepts, they have all these things in common, but there are also some differences.
Could it also go the other way, like negative one?
Yeah, you can put in negative one, and we'll get out negative one.
Yeah, just go the other.
So you can go down one and then go left one.
Oh,
never mind.
In biology, with one tree, she made like a similar reference to like parents and kids. And, like, is that just like a thing?
We're trying to brainwash you.
Is that the answer you were looking for?
Yes. This is called the parent function. The parent function. The linear function on which all other linear functions are kind of based. The most basic linear function. Slope of 1, y-intercept of 0. It goes right through the origin, it has up 1, over 1, up 1, over 1, up 1, over 1. And that's the slope, real simple. Okay. So this will look like that, but we can describe how it looks different. Okay. Maybe I recognize this as a line with a y-intercept of 0 and a slope of negative 3, so I could go y-intercept of 0, down 3 and over 1. If you don't notice that, again, if ever in doubt, just plug things in for x and get the y values. Okay? The y value in this case is called h of x. Plug in x. Easy to plug in 0. I'm clearly going to get out 0. I'll plug in 1, and I'm going to get out negative 3. This function is very simple. You just multiply the input by negative 3. That's your output. How is this graph like this graph?
Well, I was just going to say, if you put them together, it's like they intersect at the origin.
Okay, so they intersect at the origin, so they both go through the origin. Mm-hmm. Right? So that is a noteworthy thing to say. They both go through the origin, or the y-intercepts are both 0, or you can say it in lots of different ways. So both go through origin. Some lines don't go through the origin. Some lines go through here somewhere, or down here somewhere. What else is different about these two lines? Well, that's the same. What's different about these two lines?
The one on the left has a number next to the x.
Okay, and what effect does that have on the graph? Like this one has a number next to the x too, it's just the number 1.
It slants the line to the left.
It's, instead of up and to the right, it goes up and to the left. That's what we call a negative slope.
A negative and positive.
I was going to call on you right after I said that. So it has a negative slope.
Skills.
Catch.
No, that was a good mark. Okay. So both go through the origin, but this one has a negative slope. This one has a positive slope. How about? Is one of these lines steeper than the other one?
Did you mean to give this one to Hudson?
Yeah. I'm very curious to her. She asked a question.
Well, so
I think I have it too, I guess.
Right. That's a good point. I should have thrown one. Thrown one to Destiny as well. So here's a negative slope, here's a positive slope. What about the steep? Is this steeper or is this steeper?
The left one.
The first one's steeper.
This guy over here, this is steeper than that one, right? If I was trying to go up this one or up this one, then this would be harder. And this would be steeper. Okay, we can say it was steeper. Steeper has a negative slope as opposed to a positive slope. We're trying to notice the difference between these two things. Okay, we're going to, in general, want to talk about things called transformations of graphs. That means making them steeper, making them go up, making them go down, making them go right, making them go left. All these kinds of things. It's hard to see with a line all the things that you can do to affect function in a graph, but it's the beginning.
So basically, like when you add certain numbers, it affects the graph in different ways.
Exactly. If I change what the function looks like, it's got to change what the graph looks like, right? Because the graph is just the input and output of the function. And if I put something over here with the x, it's got to give me different outputs than just x by itself.
Could you make the graph like so that you have your basic one? Could you make it go all the way around,
like in a circle,
375 degrees?
360.
Well, no, like half a circle. Like,
oh.
So that's almost.
You're wondering if there's a graph that looks like this?
not necessarily, but kind of.
Well, the answer is yes and no. There are. We can get a graph that looks. We can pretty much get a graph that looks like anything.
Like
a really crazy
linear.
Well, the only functions that are linear are lines. So if it starts to curve at all, it's not linear anymore.
Well, I mean, like the slope. Like, could you get the slope to go all the way around and then?
I think I see what you're saying. So you're saying, can we change the slope so that the line kind of flips?
Yeah.
Not that the graph kind of spins, but
the line flips all the way through the.
So I get some line that, like, here, I'll take this line and then I can spin these things around. Like, so it does this?
Yeah.
Well, certainly, if I put the line like this, it has some kind of slope. And this line has some slope, and this line has some slope, and this line has some slope. If we take this line and we rotate it all the way around 360 degrees, and then some more, well, that's just a line that has a slope that's slightly bigger than this slope.
Right, so it's
so
basically going to be like the one before, yeah. And like before you turn it around.
Yeah.
Okay.
So this might have a slope of like 2, right?
It's like
twice as fast. It's up 2 and over 1 maybe instead of up 1.
Yeah.
I'm
I really hope this works.
Okay.
Brace yourself.
What?
So that's 31. Excuse me. And when it says compare to f of x equals x, that's f of x equals x. It always looks like that. And we can compare other lines to that.
The
instant I just finished writing that X, it should have been silent. I shouldn't have to fight your conversations every time I want to start doing some more math class, okay? I know that there's nothing really to do as I'm writing it down, but let's be conscious of what's going on up here. Okay, so this is going to be another graph. It's going to be the graph of a different line, different than negative 3x, different than x. It's going to look like, well, it's going to have a y-intercept of 0. It's going to have a slope of negative 7 halves. You go down 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and over 2. Okay, so how does that compare to? Guys, 1, 1, 0, 0. How does this guy compare to that?
Negative the negative thing.
What's the thing?
Okay.
That's negative?
Slope.
Slope, negative slope. This one has guess what, you go same and different. Different is the slope. It's negative. Okay?
The same as the origin again.
The or goes to the origin.
The origin.
Yeah?
Well, the second one goes from negative to positive, but the first one goes from negative to negative, so they both have negative.
So again, they both have negative, both have negative what?
They both have negative, numbers in that, because you can't.
Like negative x's?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so they both, they have the, I guess, the same domain. We talked about domain, how domain is all the x's. So both have the same domain. Yeah, that's the same. True?
No.
Just stretching the wings.
Yeah.
Agree?
They're both linear.
Of course, they're both linear. That is the same. Can't argue with that. What's the difference?
Oh.
Yep. Oh.
One's positive and negative.
What do you mean when you say it's positive? What's positive?
The slope.
Okay, we said that. We said that that this slope is negative. So we said that that was different. Right?
Yeah.
I just wrote that down already.
That's right.
You're right about that.
Different coordinates.
Different coordinates, yeah. I mean, that is, as soon as we like multiply x by anything other than 1, and they're going to have different coordinates. What we're really saying is that for any given x, we get a different y, which is kind of the nature of it being different. But except for one coordinate is the same.
Zero.
Zero.
The graph mx, the bottom, is closer to the y-axis than the fx.
Yeah, what is that?
I got it.
True?
One of them is steeper.
That kind of describes what you're saying, right? Yeah, like, go to -7, and this is closer to the y-axis. Then if you go to this -7, that's farther away from the y-axis. Exactly, yeah, that's good. So I would say steeper is different. Steeper. Yeah. Okay, well, I mean, we can do this for a long time, but there are some good similarities and differences between these two graphs.
Okay, he's not the English teacher.
Now that seems to wrap it up for your questions.
Yeah.
Okay. We'll pass no more slides. Two slips.
Oh,
yeah?
I have another question.
What?
So, I was kind of confused on how to graph them.
Oh.
Like, I wrote out the problems and stuff, but I didn't know anything
about
it.
Yeah, it's because
I'm
kind of trying to be sensitive about general graphs.
What's
the definition? A graph
is
yeah,
a way to map out a
function. And I would like to give you a 2-point egg if you can tell me what a function is.
It's an input and output.
Yeah, it's a machine, like a vending machine, or any other kind of machine that takes inputs and turns them into outputs. And a graph is a way to map that out. Okay? So if we can find inputs and outputs, and put them on the plane as points, and we can get enough points so that it starts to look like some kind of a shape, paint the shape on all of these graphs on this quiz right now in the year is a line. Right? The shape will always be a line right now. Later it'll be different shapes. But this shape that we're drawing is a graph, or is a line, and we know that we only need 2 points. Right? At least 2 points. The graph 3, this is kind of redundant. It's just a little more extra work. Because if I were to connect those 2 points and then find a third one, it would just land on that line.
Yeah.
Did you have something?
No.
Okay. Look like you did. Stretching the old wing.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we have a function. Let's start with some functions that we're unfamiliar with to drive home the point to what you can do if you're ever in doubt. So if you got an idea to have something to write on, unless you feel like a superstar and you don't need any of this advice.
We're taking a test.
A quiz. A pretty short quiz.
Right there. Right there.
But I wanted to... Is it going on? It's a quiz. Color, paper.
Right now?
Okay. I want to go over with you some fundamentals about graphing and about just quick reviews about like the domain range and little things like that. Just a refresher before we start. So I don't have the advantage with this function like I do with the ones we're gonna have on the quiz, because I know the ones on the quiz when I graph them will always turn out to be what shape?
Line.
This one, I'm not so sure about. It doesn't look like a linear function. It's not a linear function. It won't be a line. So this gets down to Don't try and remember the steps. Because if you make a mistake, you're making a mistake about what you remember. And you just have to go back and erase that memory and replace it with a new correct memory. What you want to do is, if you're getting something wrong, you want it to be because you just need more understanding. You want to understand what you're grasping, understand what those points represent. And if you don't know how to find those points, or don't know where those points are, you do know how to find them, and you do know how to find them based on what it function is, rather than, oh, I see this number here, that number means go here, and this number means put a dot here, but I don't really know why those dots go where those dots go. Okay? So, if you're looking at a function and it says to graph, this goes for every graph forever for the rest of your life, and it says to graph it, and you're in doubt, you don't know what it looks like, you don't know what point to put where, how can you find at least one point?
Zero for x.
Zero for x. Sure. Or?
Zero for
anything.
Well, zero for, especially in this one, zero for y would be a lot trickier. Or what?
Anything.
Anything for
one. Any number for x.
Any number for x. Zero is a great choice.
One.
One is a good choice in this particular function.
I was going to say that a linear, is it not a linear line because it has an exponent in it? Or
yes.
It
that's a quick way to be able to tell that because I'm an x squared, this is not going to be a straight line.
Okay.
So we just start putting things in for x. And the easiest thing to do in this case is plug in 0, and 1's not too hard either. Negative 1 wouldn't be too bad. You just start plugging numbers in. So 0, I don't even need to write this down. 0, 0 plus 3, I get 3. So I know a point. Well, that one point doesn't tell me about much about what this graph is supposed to be shaped like. So I just keep going. I try a 1. I can do some work over here. 1 squared plus 2 times 1 plus 3 is 1 plus 2 plus 3 is 6. Negative 1. Negative 1 inside the parentheses squared. Remember, as I said, if you want to replace a number in an expression like that, you want to replace x with a number. My recommendation is put parentheses where the x was and fill it with the number. That way you make sure the negatives make it where they're supposed to. Plus 2 times negative 1 plus 3. That's 1 minus 2 plus 3. Okay, so 1 minus 2 is negative 1 plus 3 is 2. Okay, well we found two more points. So, or, sorry. Yeah, two more points. So on negative 1, 2.
I'm trying to color code it a little bit.
I like that.
I don't.
Well, some people like things and other people don't like things. 1, 6. Even if Dimitri hadn't pointed this out already, do you think this is going to be a line?
No.
No, if it was going to be a line, we expect a steady slope between all the points. If this goes up 1 over 1, this goes up 3 and over 1. That's not a line. That's going to be a curve.
We naturally
expect to see a curve. If I were to plot more points in between 0 and 1, if I were to plug in 1 half and 3 fourths and 4, 2, 5, I bet I'll get some kind of a bunch of points that winds up curving a little bit like that. And then if I went in between these two, then we curve and get to there, probably like that. I don't feel like I really have much of a grasp of what this graph looks like as a whole, so just keep plotting points. When in doubt, plug something in for x. Try negative 2. Negative 2 squared plus 2 times negative 2 plus 3, that's 4, minus 4, plus 3, so that's just going to be 3. Negative 2, 3. Look at that. That point is now up above this point, so it seems like the points come down maybe to here. Maybe this is the lowest point, and now the points go up from there. Whether or not that's the lowest point, we don't really need to bother with that right now. We just need to start to get an idea. Does this graph go down like that? Does it go up like that? Does it flatten out like that? Just plug in more x's to find out. If I knew there was a point down here, I would know that the point's kind of going to come down here. If there was a point up here, I'd know I need to kind of shoot over that direction. So I'll try and save myself a little time. Maybe I'll go to negative 6. Just go pretty far out there. Let's see. Does it seem like the points are going up? Or does it seem like they come back down? Or does it seem like they do something else? So you get negative 6 squared plus 2 times negative 6 plus 3. So we got 36 minus 12 plus 3. 36 minus 12 plus 24 plus 3 is 27. That's a pretty big Y value. Negative 6, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 27. I think at the scale I couldn't even fit 27 on the screen. It seems like if there's a point way up there above the top of the screen, that all the other points are probably just going to keep going up and up and up and up towards that point and probably just keep going up even past that. And I bet these points will also go up like that.
The line on the left is flawless.
Flawless?
Yeah, the one that you just drew.
This one?
Yeah.
Thank you. So by plotting bunches of points, we see that the shape of the graph should be all of the points, all infinity of them, will just wind up mushing together, being so close together that they look like this curvy thing. This thing called a parabola. So we got another function that's not linear, and then we'll talk about maybe what's the best way to graph a linear function. Now, we have to
talk about that.
Now, square root. You know what square root means, right?
Yeah.
Now, do you know what the square root of 7 is?
Yeah.
Square root of 7?
2.
It has one. There's
one.
A number, some decimal.
It's not a whole number.
That multiplies by, yeah, it's not a whole number. So
2.5.
What's that?
2.5.
2.5?
Yeah.
No. It's 2.7.
Yeah, I would agree. It is
2.7. 2.7.
Well. The answer is, when I ask you square root of 7, you're like, it's something like this number, but I don't know what number it is exactly. Do you know a number that has an exact square root?
4.
Okay, 4.
8.
Okay, now hold on. Okay, paying attention? We want to take the square root of something like 4. Can we put something in for x so that what's inside the square root winds up being 4?
Negative 1.
If I put negative 1 in there, I'll do 5 minus 1 is 4, square root of 4 is 2. Could I plug in 0?
No.
I can't? It's impossible?
No, you can.
Yeah, okay, you can. Do you want to?
No.
Why not?
Decimal.
Because it'll come out decimal. I don't want to come out decimal. I want to come out whole numbers.
Can you show how you did? How you got
Yes, I put in negative 1 for x, negative 1 plus 5, that's the square root of 4, that's 2.
Oh, I got it.
Okay. What else is a good idea to plug in for x?
Negative 2.
Negative 2, why is that?
Wait, never mind.
You don't like negative 2? Okay,
never
let's
mind.
Do something else. What's a different number, Drew?
1.
Just the number 1?
Negative 5.
Yep.
I heard Drew says number 1. What do you think about the number 1?
I like it.
What would happen? We would take the square root of?
6.
You know what the square root of 6 is?
No.
Oh, jeez.
No, I don't know the square root. Not that you can't.
Negative.
You can, but it comes out of decimal, like you said.
Yeah.
Jason. 4. 4, you like 4?
Yes.
Everybody else like 4?
Yeah.
Why? Because it makes it the square root of?
9.
Square
nine.
Root of? 9, which
oh,
is
3.
Negative
5.
Negative 5, I like that. Everybody else like that? Because it makes you take the square root of?
0.
0, and the square root of 0 is?
0.
So now what we're starting to see is there are smart choices, maybe better choices than others, to plug in for x. Back here it seemed like, whatever, just plug in 1, 2, 3, 4, it doesn't matter. Here it matters. Because some things are easier than others. It's easier to take the square root of 9, the square root of 4, the square root of 16, the square root of 25, the square root of 0, the square root of 1. How about if we put negative 4? That'd be good?
No.
Negative 4 plus 5 is 1. You know the square root of 1?
1.
Oh,
it's
wait.
1.
Yeah, it would.
Now we got some good points.
Oh, God.
Negative 1, 2.
3, 4.
4, 3. Make sure you don't get those y's and x's backwards when you plot points. Negative 5, 0, 2, 3, 4, 5. Negative 4, 1. Nice, you see? And remember, I said if we plug in 2, right, we'll take the square root of 7. If we said it's 2 point something, well, the square root, when I plug in negative 1, that's 2. When I plug in 4, the square root of 9 is 3. So yeah, there's somewhere between 2 and 3. That's what I would expect to get when I plug in 2 for x, because I would take the square root of 7.
Is that our function?
Yes.
Top left. All right.
That is a function. Because I get to put things into it, I get things out of it, input, output. And importantly, when I put something in, I get one thing out. Like, for example, I don't put in 7, get out 12 and 6. I don't get two numbers out. I just get one number out. I add 5, I take the square root, there's only one answer. So it looks like these points will follow a pattern like this, something like this. Okay, what is a decent graph? The square root of x is 5. So thinking when, in doubt,
plug in for x.
Plug in. You do that, you do the fundamentals enough times, the shortcuts and the faster ways of doing it become
easy.
More obvious to my mind. More understandable. You know why they are the shortcuts that they are.
I was wondering if we could just do like another example of doing tilting. I just never got that. I just don't understand.
The what?
I will do that. I will do an example.
Just like, can you, and also can you just explain it? I just
of what?
Domain.
Okay,
we will talk about domain and range. But quickly, we'll talk about some linear functions. Okay. In the previous example, I was trying to get across the point that sometimes there's some things that you plug in for x that are better than other things you plug in for x. They're better ideas. Y equals, let's say, 4/7 x plus 2. My good old friend, the linear function. Okay. I know that it's going to come out to be a line. So the one big advantage is I only need to find 2 points and then I can just connect them. Because I know where all the other points will be. Okay, can I go a y-intercept of 2 and a slope up 4 over 7? Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
Do I understand what that means? The answer is no. You should go back to plugging in things for x. Thinking about it that way until you say, oh, I see. 0 and 7. Zero for x gives me 0 plus 2. 7 for x. So 4 plus 2 is 6. I only need 2 points, I don't think it'll be 1. Yes?
So I know how to do the rise over run.
Okay.
So go up 2 on the y line. And then
okay.
Rise.
Hold on, wait, catch up. You go up 2 on the y axis.
Right.
So what's that? That's just.
That's
what I get when I plug in 0 for x.
Right.
And then?
And then you go up 4 because that's the rise.
Uh-huh. 1, 2, 3, 4.
And then you go over 7 because that's
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Well, we went over 7. No coincidence that 7 is the next easiest thing to plug in for x. Okay. And when I go up 4, starting from 2, go up 4 from there, I went over 6. So the slope is just a result of asking, what would be the next easiest thing to plug in for x? 7. Hudson?
You said like you only need 2 points to know it's going to be a line?
No, not to know that it's going to be a line.
Oh, I thought you said that, and I was wondering how you didn't know it's going to be like a curve.
It's kind of backwards. You know it's going to be a line, so I know that I only need 2 points.
Oh, how did you know it's going to be a line?
How do I know it's going to be a line? Because it looks like this. The equation that I'm looking at looks like this. He's got x to the first power, not to the second or third or fourth. It's just the number times x to the first power plus or minus another number. That must be my positive or negative. If it looks like that, or if it's possible to rewrite it so it looks like that, you know it's going to be a linear equation. Another common way to see that a linear equation is like this. Ax plus by equals c. Because you know what you can do? You can solve for y. You can get y by itself. And then this will just look like that. And it'll look like this. It'll look like something times x plus b. So that's how I know it's going to look like a line. If I was completely inexperienced and I didn't know that, I would just need to plot like three or four or five lines or points. But if I plot, you know, a point at negative 7, I'm going to wind up with a point here. If I went to 14 for x and I plotted this point, I would start to see these aren't making a curve, they are making a straight line. And that's just an observation we've made over time. Exactly.
Oh, but it's good to
really go take care of it, whatever you need to do.
That's so cool.
All right? So, the more we do this, like, you know, let me just write a bunch of functions on this next page. Y equals negative 2/3 x minus 4 equals 4 times x plus x y. Oh my god, 5/3 x plus 4, all of that stuff. If I keep doing this and making the best choices for x, the first best choice is always
0.
This is where the y-intercept shortcut comes from. It's just plugging 0 in for the first value of x. If I plug in 0, I'll always get this number. That's why we can just throw that point on the y-axis. If I plug in 0 for x, I'll get negative 6 in this case. Here I'll get positive 4 if I plug in 0 for x. There's our y-intercept. That's why this number always tells us what the y-intercept is, because if I plug in 0 for x, it just goes away. Slope is negative 2/3 down 2 and over 3. Why is that? Because I want to go to x is 3, because x is 3 will cancel out the denominator of 3. I go over 3 to that x value, because I won't have any fractions to deal with. That'll be the next whole number that I can get out of this function. I plug in 3. Cancel, I get minus 2, down 2. Negative 4, minus 2, when I go over to x is 3. Here, up 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, over 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Why? Because if I go to x is 9, that is the next time I'll get a whole number for my output. Y-intercept of 4, slope of 5/3, negative 5/3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and over 3. Because the next x value that I want to plug into this function is 3, because the denominator is 3, I want to cancel out the denominator. Negative 5/3 times 3 plus 4. 3's cancel. Down 5, right? For 4, I go down 5. 4, y is 4, minus 5. That happens at x equals 3. The y-intercept and the slope, but if we're doing it by memory, and sometimes you get the slope backwards, and sometimes I make the slope positive when it should be negative, or sometimes I do run over rise instead of rise over run. If you're doing that, if you're making those mistakes, and you come to me and you say, what should I do? I'm going to point out that how we know what the slope is supposed to be, how we know if it's positive, how we know if we go up into the right or down into the right, is just by plugging things in for x, the best thing. And if you're forgetting and you're not sure how to graph it, when in doubt, plug in things for x. And just think what would be the easiest thing to plug in for x. Okay. Now if our function does look like this, so that's y. That's still a linear function. Just happen to know that from my experience. your experience that knowledge is there. So I know I still need 2 points. So it's just a little game. How do I find 2 points really easily? Let's go back to plugging in something here and there. What would be the easiest thing to plug in?
Zero.
Zero for what?
X.
Of course, for x. Because we plug things in for x all the time. Right? Plug in zero for x, we'll get nothing there. 6y equals 12. Divide by 6, y equals 2. Need one more point, Hudson?
Zero for y.
Zero for y. Well, that's easy. That's 4. X plus nothing equals 12, and x is 3. All done, as I said, I know this is going to be a line. I just need 2 points. The easiest 2 points to find, because it's written this way, I need 0 for x and 0 for y, you have 2 points. 0, 2, 3, 0. Because we know all these graphs are going to be lines, finding 2 points is all we need to do. What are the easiest 2 points to find? It depends on how the equation is written. Here I would plug in 0 for x and 0 for y. Here I'd plug in 0, and then whatever this is, that's what I'd plug in next. If you've done enough times, you notice, oh, that's the slope.
Mm-hmm.
When I just plug in 3 and then 6 and then 9 and so on, I'm just following the slope. So let's talk about, well, unless there's a question about that. You guys feel good about that? Okay, let's talk about the mean. Y equals root x plus 7. So there's a function, an input and output. If I say that I'm going to change the domain, then I'm going to change what you're allowed to plug in for x. It might look like this. X is greater than or equal to negative 3. In all these other functions, I haven't said anything about x. I might as well, if I was going to tell you what the domain was, I might as well have said, plug anything you want in for x. And then for this one, plug anything you want in for x. And for this one, plug anything you want in for x. That's the domain. But for this one, the domain is smaller. X can only take on values that are greater than or equal to negative 3. Okay? Can I plug negative 4 in there?
No.
Negative 7?
No.
Nothing to the left of negative 3. Can I plug in negative 3?
Yeah.
Yes, because we have equals 2. Can I plug in 0?
Yeah.
4.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's lots of, like, I can plug in 0. That's a value I like to plug in for 0 for x. Right?
Yeah.
I can plug in 3. That's something I'd like to plug in for x. That'd be
6,
9, 12. So on. I just won't plug in values for x that are less than negative 3, which means there will be no graph beyond that. I don't have to draw this, but in my mind I know there will be no graph over here, no graph here. That's what saying x is greater than or equal to negative 3 means. There's no graph over there past negative 3. But it still does, it still, you can plug in 0, so I have the y-intercept, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, follow the slope of 2 over 3. Because if I plug in 3, I'm just going to wind up adding 2, I'm going to get 3, 9. That go back here, but stop.
Oh, boom.
At negative 3. There's no more graph past negative 3. And I'll put a closed circle because we have equals 2. If I didn't have equals 2,
open circle.
Open circle. No more equals 2.
Yeah, girl.
Means open circle instead of close circle. That's all that means. It just means. Don't plug in those x values because I said not to.
Yeah.
So that's the domain. The domain is x is greater than negative 3. The domain is all of the things that x can be.
It makes
it
really
if domain is all the things that x can be, what's the range? All the things that y can be. Right? Listen, can you take a crack at what y values can we get from this function?
Oh, what
was
the
answer,
right?
Yeah, I mean, that's the same question.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
The greatest number x can be and the smallest number.
You're thinking of it in terms of like statistics where I take a set of numbers and I take the biggest one minus the smallest one. That's not what the range is in a function. The The range is, you're just telling me y can be this, y can be this, y can be this. These are the things that y can be. Let me ask you, look at the graph. You can see the y values, right? Here are the points on the line. Can y be 0? Can I get a y of 0 in the graph? No.
No.
No. If I look at y as 0, here it is. Y is 0. Right? This is y is positive, y is negative. I don't see the graph anywhere along here. So no, y, like 0 is not part of the range.
It would have to be greater than or equal to like 4 or 5.
Depending on what that y value is?
Yeah.
I can't get negative 7, I can't get negative 5, I can't get negative 2, I can't get 0, I can't get 1, I can't get 2, I can't get 3. Well, let's find out exactly what it is that,
yeah,
that number is. How will I find out what that y value is? Or the function is the thing that tells me the y value. What x value am I interested in?
The y. Negative 3.
Negative 3 is like, I'm asking myself, what y value do I get at negative 3? Well, I plug it in. 2/3 times negative 3 over 1 plus 7. Cancel, I get a negative 1 here. Negative 2 plus 7, 5. That's what that y value is right there. Which means this graph isn't very good. It should be like 5. So 5 is the biggest or the smallest that y can be?
The smallest.
I can't get 4. I can't get 4.5. I can't get 4.75. 5 is the smallest. So y would have to be bigger than 5. Could it be equal to 5?
Mm-hmm. No.
No. Because I actually can't plug in negative 3. Right? There's an open circle there. So the y value, there's a like an open circle at negative 3, 5. So y can't be 5, but it can't be anything bigger than 5. It can be 5.000001, anything bigger than 5. It goes out from there. Okay. Does that make sense? Well, if it's anything greater than negative 3.
Okay, that's what I thought, but I should
be. Anything less than negative 3, we are not allowed to plug in. Or even equal to negative 3, we're not supposed to plug that in according to this formula.
And is that for all the ranges or for the arrow?
Well, it depends on what something like this says.
Yeah, so if the thingy little
that guy.
That little,
it's like that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay, so it depends
on
which way it's pointing.
Yeah, this one, if I put this domain here instead of that one, then basically I would have no graph over here. I would have all the graph over here across to that. Okay.
Take these weights.
That. When in doubt, what are you supposed to do?
Plug in more.
Plug in something for
stuff.
X. Okay, can you plug anything for X? Probably. Most functions we use have anything you want. But there are easier values for X to deal with than others. Zero is usually good. Anything that cancels out the denominator is good. Okay. Just get ready.